Today's topic is Staffing and Training for International Assignments. This is Cross Cultural Management, BMH 571. Basically, when we talk about international assignments or overseas assignments, there's a lot of challenges which are being faced by an HR manager as regards staffing and training for these assignments, because expatriates, they come to the country who are of different nationality and different culture, and so adjusting into the local environment becomes a challenge. And hence, the importance of learning about staffing and training becomes inevitable. So, we'll start up with the lecture. Basically, the first step in staffing involves human resource planning, which is the process of forecasting an international organization's future demand for and supply of the right type of people in the right number. So here, we are actually estimating the number of employees required, especially when we talk about the overseas assignment, how many people would be required to work on the project. That has to be estimated. So human resource planning facilitates the realization of the objectives, organizational objectives, by providing right type and right number of personnel. So the first step, very first step in staffing is human resource planning, and we here give the estimation of the required number of people or expatriates who would be coming from another country to work on the current project. Selecting staff for international assignment is a complex undertaking for several reasons, including, now there are reasons why it is a challenge, why it is so complex, so difficult in itself. So the first thing is identifying a suitable person for the assignment. If there is an assignment in USA, that is a subsidiary is being established in USA, and the parent country or the home country is India, then the person would have to be called from Indian home organization to US. And so it becomes very difficult to assess what type of person would be required. The qualities, the qualifications, experience would have to be matched to the current requirements. Predicting his or her performance in a new, culturally, potentially very different environment. Now here, certainly the environment would be very different because of cultural differences, because of language, because of the norms which are being followed in the organizations. So, prediction of how this person is going to perform here in an international environment would be very difficult. Dealing with personal and family related issues and problems. Now this is very important because most of the expatriates, they fail because of this reason of spouse issues or family issues, that why an expatriate failed on an international assignment. So this is very important, family related issues, because in case the spouse is working, the job has to be adjusted, the kids' education has to be adjusted. So all these issues have to be dealt in while selecting the right type of employee at an international assignment. Devising an appropriate compensation package. Now giving the same compensation package would not be possible because various countries, countries follow different compensation packages. For instance, in USA, compensation package includes COLA, that is cost of living allowance, which is replaced by DLS allowance in India. So it's quite similar to it, but then the difference is there, and that too varies depending on various zones in US. So like Western zone is much more expensive as compared to the Eastern zone. So that would also vary. So determination of this compensation package in itself becomes very tough task. Complying with host country regulations. Now it's also important that while selecting the staff for this assignment, you have to take into care the laws, the rules, regulations of that specific country, which can be pertaining to work permits, visa regulations. All these are the issues which have to be dealt in while thinking of getting a person for an international assignment. Now here, what should be the criteria for selecting staff for international assignments? what should be the various criteria, like what we have to decide, on what basis we should actually get people for international or overseas assignment. The first thing is, the first criteria we can call is technical ability. That is, whether the person is actually able or not, he is technically skilled or not, he knows how to work on machines, he knows how to work on softwares if required, means if it is a requirement of a job, then whether he has full knowledge about it or not. So technical ability is a very important issue while selecting the employee for an international assignment. Then is cross-cultural suitability. Whether the employee you are getting in is culturally sensitive or not, or he can adjust to the other cultures, various cultures or not, because that is very important. Adaptability is very important. So whether he would be able to work in a diverse workforce culture or not, wherein you will find people of different cultures, different ages, genders, and various types of people you might find there. So it would be very difficult, you know, that cross-cultural suitability has to be assessed. Family requirements. Whether, you know, when by getting a person for an overseas assignment, it becomes very important to assess what are the family requirements. Whether the kids are studying or not, so do they have a college or a school which is at par with whatever they are doing currently. So that is one issue. Another thing is whether the spouse is working or not. So if he or she is working, then getting them here, you know, providing them with some opportunity wherein, you know, the change would be easily done. Then is organization specific requirements. Whether the expatriate you are looking for actually meets the specific requirements of the organization or not. If a job requires an experience, whether this person carries an overseas experience or not, that would form one of the criteria of selection. Language. Language is very important because you know, understanding the people around you, the understanding of the cues, the gestures is very important. So that language plays a very important role here by selecting the employee for this assignment. Country cultural requirements. Now, you know, if the person is ready to adjust into the cultural requirements of another country, for instance, if a person goes out from India to say some like Arabic country or some you know, Middle East countries where the women are required to wear a formal dress. So that's, you know, whether the person will be able to adjust in that environment or not. So that's the country cultural requirements which have to be adhered to, which have to be met, and which have to be adapted by the expatriate. So these would be the criteria for selecting the staff for international assignments. There are certain issues which are involved in employee selection. While selecting an employee, certain thoughts have to be you know, kept in mind while going for employee selection. The first thing is linking staffing plans to the evolution of the MNC. If a subsidiary is being set up into India and the home country is in US, then what is the evolution stage of that MNC in India? Whether, if we talk about the business cycle, it starts from introduction stage, then growth, then maturity, and then decline. So does the business cycle is one of the, you know, is one in one of the stages of the business. So accordingly, we have to see how can we link the staffing plan there. If we are recruiting people to be sent to India, then we have to take into account you know, what should be and how the staffing plans should be framed, because for each and every different stage the staffing plan would differ. Now especially, we can see this here. If we are planning to setting up the host unit, like the example I took was a US based company is setting up a subsidiary in India. So, you know, how should we do that? If it is only at the setting up stage, that is the introduction stage of the business cycle, then these would be the requirements of the staffing plans. Firstly, the focus staffing challenges, pace is slow, because right now you are just thinking of establishing a subsidiary. Staffing challenges would be plenty, and the pace of getting in people would be a bit slow. You can have around 5 to 10 employees at this moment of time, because you have just started up with the plan. Staffing approach, which we are going to cover in the next part, that is ethnocentric or geocentric approach, what approach should be followed. Role of parent MNC, closely and carefully monitored by the parent MNC. So what is the, you know, whether it's going to have a micromanagement on the subsidiary or it's going to delegate the powers and the subsidiary would be quite independent to take its own decision. So that is again what is going to be looked upon. So, but here at this stage, it's going to be closely monitored by the parent MNC. The second thing is establishing the technology team to begin core operational activities. Now here, the subsidiary is already being set up, and now you are actually thinking of establishment of technology team to begin the activities in the subsidiary which you have already been established. So here, unit staffing challenges. Pace is fast, hiring obtains individuals with high emphasis on competency. Because now you are actually focusing on starting up the operational activities, you would be more focused on getting individuals which are high on competency, specialization, skills, and around 20 to 200 employees may be hired in this stage. The approach you may follow is polycentric approach, which is preferred here at this particular stage. And role of parent MNC, it is reduced, because here now you are actually having more of skilled people. So the parent MNC would not actually micro, that control would not be very much close. In fact, it's going to be a bit loose, and so it is reduced. The third stage is full blown established operations of the host unit with significant role in establishing global targets. Now the company has already been established, and you have set up a team there, technology team, and now you are thinking of how you can actually compete globally. So for that reason, if at this stage the staffing challenges would increase and the hiring targets would also increase, now you need more people to work in that organization and to because you need more experience and more people here. So obviously the headcount would increase from 200 to 1000. The staffing approach is polycentric, and role of parent MNC is minimal, as depending more on the unit to manage. Now because you are hiring up to a level of 1000, obviously you would be depending upon the host country wherein you are hiring those people there, the local people around. So they would be more of decision makers. And so the role of parent MNC would actually decline. Now this is the last stage we call as strong leadership at the unit level by globally consolidating with the parent. Now you wish to make it more stronger. The subsidiary has a leader, and you are actually trying to represent yourself as one of the units of the parent company. So move to volume hiring as unit's global contributions are clear. Since you are competing globally now, your hiring, your unit's contributions are more, and so there would be a big hiring, volume hiring, which might range in between 500 to 10,000 people. Staffing approach is polycentric, that is more of local based approach, and role of parent MNC is at strategic level to take decisions to optimize global operating cost. Now see, these are all various stages in a business cycle if a subsidiary is being set up into another country. And Every stage will have its own staffing approach, its own number of employees to be hired, and how many people, what is the role of parent MNC. All this would actually be different with a different stage. So we have seen that this is the first thing, like in our last slide, this is the first issue which has to be dealt in while we think of employee selection. Then we have staffing orientations, what were there in various staffing plans which we have discussed earlier. In the last lecture also I have covered these staffing orientations, but just to brief you up, there are three staffing orientations. Ethnocentric approach or orientation, polycentric orientation, and geocentric orientation. Ethnocentric orientation is one wherein a subsidiary is being set up into a host country and the parent country imposes its culture on that specific host country unit. So that is being imposed directly there, and when it is imposed, obviously people from parent company, they go to the host country and work there, and they actually want to standardize everything, and the culture is being totally adopted from the parent country. That is an ethnocentric approach, and people would not want any deviations from what culture they are following at the parent company. Second approach or orientation is polycentric orientation, wherein if a subsidiary is being set up into another country, somewhat adaptation is being done with the host country culture, and people are hired from that country itself, irrespective of national, it's like they are hired on the basis of experience and skills. And generally more of operational work is being conducted by these post country nationals, while we talk about policy decisions, these are generally taken up by the parent country nationals only. Third is the geocentric orientation. Now this orientation is actually which focuses on a very broad perspective, and here it believes that the people should be hired based on merits and not based on any form of nationality. So it would hire people, whether if you are setting up a subsidiary in India, then you might hire people from Australia, from Japan, from various other countries if they are capable and they have a willingness to work. So they would be hired and they would work here. So this was the second issue which we consider while selecting an employee. Third is the point of managing expatriates. Now the question arises, we have discussed it before also, what or who is an expatriate. Now when we talk of an expatriate, he is a person who leaves his country of citizenship and moves to another country to work. So he is an expatriate. So the problem arises of managing these expatriates. The first thing is willingness and enthusiasm of a person to work abroad. Whether, once we call people from another country and while calling them to pursue their work here, first what has to be seen is whether they are willing and they are actually enthusiastic of working there. Multiculturalist means the person is very sensitive to other cultures, he is ready to adapt, this has to be seen. Then possess skills for positions overseas. So what skills he has, that has to be studied, and whether it would comply with the requirements of the job at an international assignment. Family background of the individual, again that has to be checked, and accordingly the expatriate would be caught. And the last issue which has to be dealt in with while selection of these employees is role of female expatriates. Now studies reveal that female expatriates make up a very small proportion, that is maybe less than 10% of the total expatriate population. Now, what are the reasons for this small percentage? Females are less desirous than males of international assignments, firstly because of personal reasons, because of unwillingness to move. So females are less likely to be offered international assignments. There are a comparatively smaller number of females with the requisite skills to be sent on international assignments. Many repressive cultures discourage the sending of female expatriates. Now it's again another issue, cultural issue. In many repressive cultures, males do not like reporting to females. So it's again a cultural issue. So these are the various reasons why you would find very less percentage of female expatriates working overseas. Lastly, while covering the staffing part, we would see what are the recent trends in international staffing. What is going on around when we talk about this international staffing? The first thing is managing diversity. Managing diversity it's a challenge for the managers, because they would certainly call in expatriates and that would form a diverse culture in the organization with different genders, age, races. So how to manage would be a challenge while going in for international staffing. Outsourcing. The main idea behind outsourcing is to curb cost and also to focus more on the core capabilities. So when we talk of outsourcing, this is done basically when a company wants to grow and wants to focus more on its core competencies. So the site issues, or we can say the less important activities, are being given to somebody else, and that is outsourcing. So again, but this would have a negative impact on the organization in a way that it will result into loss of jobs. There is background checks nowadays which is being done for international assignments. That is, people are going in for checking referral, going in for referral checks, checking whether the employees are actually, they have a good code of conduct and from what background they are, what is the experience. So this is what is going on. Sources of recruitment. Nowadays, if you talk about surveys, they more focus on e-recruitment, which is the upcoming method of staffing, and it's actually the new, most of the companies are adopting it. Others are also there as placing an advertisement in the newspaper or various other employee referrals, internal referrals. All these are various other methods, but e-recruitment is which tops the most. And lastly, duo career couples. This is again an issue and a trend in international staffing, that is taking care of both the spouses. You know, it's like if you're calling in one employee and the spouse is working, so if his or her job could be made secure, or the company can provide him or her with another assignment. So that is another trend in international staffing. So this we have covered about the international scenario of staffing. Next we are going to do is training. How these expatriates should be trained for international assignments. So here, training strategies bridge the gap between the capabilities of the individual hired and the role of the job that he is being hired for. So training is very important when you are sending an employee for an overseas assignment, because the requirement of the job might differ from what capabilities he possess. So that would be filled up by training strategies. The four strategies are, so the companies can look for either of these strategies. The MNCs may make use of expatriates for short-term or long-term international job assignments. The staffing orientation that is adopted in the subsidiary unit influences the training impetus. The control and coordination linkages that the parent unit wishes to establish with the subsidiary unit drives the training budget and strategy. And lastly, the role and responsibilities of the position determine the extent and content of training. So these are four strategies which actually determine how the training should be conducted and what should be the length, content and rigor level of these training strategies. One of the trainings which is well known for expatriates is CCT or cross-cultural training. MNCs offer cross-cultural training to teach their expatriates the host country's appropriate norms and behaviors. So it's basically focused on how to train these expatriates. CCT is a planned intervention designed to increase the knowledge and skills of expatriates to live and work effectively and achieve life satisfaction in an unfamiliar host culture. Now, cross-cultural training would actually, you know, it's a very good training method which updates the expatriates on the culture in which they are working, and also it gives them a lot of satisfaction and it makes them learn how to adjust themselves to this work environment. Cross-cultural training should aim at imparting cross-cultural skills and knowledge to the expatriates and to facilitate their adjustment to the host country's culture. So, the basic objective of cross-cultural training is imparting cross-cultural skills and knowledge. That is, how what skills are required in an international assignment and how it can be, you know, inculcated in this expatriate so as to enable him to work smoothly in an international assignment. What are the benefits of CCT? Firstly, cross-cultural training increases the success in global assignment because the person gets adjusted to the environment, he is very comfortable working there, so he would be more focused on working there and giving good results, so which results in success. Provides a comprehensive global perspective for managers. The managers would be, you know, they will learn lot many things about other various cultures, people around and what is going on in the world around. So that will give them a global perspective. Reduces culture shock due to frequent travels abroad. Now when we talk of culture shock, you can see this culture shock curve here, which actually has, you know, two dimensions. One is happiness on the y-axis and x is the months in a foreign country, and it follows certain phases. These are various phases which are being covered under a cultural shock curve. The first one is a honeymoon period, that is, you know, it's like easy period for the person who is moving in for an international assignment. He is very enthusiastic, very happy, and you know, he is ready to work there with all his skills. Now as we move down, it slowly reduces and it takes a downward movement wherein, you know, the person is now in a culture shock. There could be several reasons for this. Maybe the person is not adjusted to the language, to the environment around, to the people. So he's in a stage of culture shock. Now here, next stage would be adjustment stage. Now in between the culture shock stage and adjustment stage, you would see an upward movement of the curve. Now it is because of here the cross-cultural training plays a very important role. CCTs, you know, they develop the people, they give them the required knowledge and skills, they make them learn the language, gestures, cues, all it is being learned by these people, and that is where the curve moves upward, and that is the adjustment stage. Now after this adjustment stage, you would see the curve is, you know, drastically moving upward, and that is adaptation. Adaptation is basically the person has learned how to work in an environment, this environment, and now he is very comfortable working in this. And so you can see a flat line after the, at the end of the curve, which says that the performance is quite good and the person is happy and emotionally stable now. So that is a culture shock which can be overcome through CCT. So these are the benefits of cross-cultural trainings. The drawbacks are also there. Firstly, it develops a false sense of confidence among employees. Now in case a person is moving to the host country, and before that, before the departure, he is being given this type of training, then he might actually, you know, gain up the confidence he knows everything. While actually moving to that place, he might come across various unexpected things for which he is not prepared. So he is developing a false sense of confidence. May not remove cultural biases and prejudices. Now, if a person already has certain biases for a specific culture, then that might not be removed by cross-cultural trainings, because CCT focuses on letting you know only about the culture of that country and what should be followed, what is the language, you know, what is the background, how you need to work, the norms. So it might not remove these cultural biases. It may not be taken seriously by the recipients. Recipients might not, you know, learn a lot from CCTs. This is another demerit. Can never fully prepare an assignee to face real problems. You actually cannot say that this is what is going to happen in an overseas assignment and for this there is a this specific solution. No. So everything is situational based, and actually it cannot teach everything or cannot, you know, give all the information to the expatriates. What are the phases in CCT program, or what are the steps which are being followed by devising a cross-cultural training program? The phase one is objectives. Objective of training in an MNC are, so first thing which you are deciding is objective. What is the requirement of a cross-cultural training? What do you want out of it? So bridging the cultural gaps between the host and the parent organization, that is one. Establishing and retaining advantages over international competitors, and building a single organizational culture across its subsidiaries. So this is the outcome which might be required out of a cross-cultural training program. Phase two is global assignments. Global assignments is the next step, that is what type of assignment is being given to the employee, and based upon that the cross-cultural training would be devised or designed. So the type of assignment will have an effect on such HR activities as selection and repatriation. There are actually four types of these assignments here. The first is CEO, the role of a CEO. Say if a person is being sent as a CEO, he would be a subsidiary manager and he would be required to actually take care of all the operations there. He would be controlling people, he would be hiring, going in for selections of people, compensation. So he is basically controlling all the activities there. So for him, a CCT to be devised would be of a different nature. The second is the job of the structure reproducer. That means if a person is being only sent to take care of the designing part of the organization, to structure it well, to actually start up with the operations and to see the technology is working properly or not. So if it has to be given, the subsidiary has to be given a proper structure, then this type of employee would be sent, and the CCT content and the legal level would differ. Then is troubleshooter. Troubleshooter is generally an employee who is being sent for a specific purpose. That is, you know, only to resolve a particular issue which is aroused in the subsidiary unit. So he is being sent there, and once that issue is over, the problem is solved, then he comes back to the parent country. And last is that of operative nature. That is all, you know, it's basically the lower level jobs. So if people are being sent to perform lower level jobs, that of production and all that factory related works, then they have to have a cross-cultural training of different content. Phase 3 we see is, the third step is need analysis. What is the need in the organization? Why it is required? That analysis has to be done at three levels. One is the organizational level, that is we will have to see that in the organization what is the requirement of CCT, what are the requirements of the organization itself so that the CCP can be framed accordingly. Individual analysis, what job demands out of this person, and so accordingly the content of the CCT would differ. Assignment analysis, what particular job requirement is there that forms the assignment analysis. Phase 4 would be deciding on term of training, that is short term or long term, that is we are deciding the duration of the training here. The next step would be deliver cross cultural training session. That is, we are actually finding out, finalizing the content part, the duration part, everything is to be finalized here. And here first thing we would decide is upon course content, what would be the language of the training, whether it has to be focused on cultural or operational issues. Next thing we would decide upon at this phase is training methods, what training methods should be taken up. Like if you see here, on the x-axis, there is focus, on the y-axis there is training rigor. These are all cross-cultural training methods. So as the rigor level increases, the methods also differ. So starting off with the basic methods would be like lectures, it can be books, classroom language training, case studies, sensitivity training, interactive language training, field trips, role plays, simulation and field experience. So from bottom till high, the training methods would increase, they would get more rigor with the level of the requirement of the job. Then we are also going to decide upon sequencing of sessions, that is whether it has to be a pre-departure CCT, that is before the person leaves for an international assignment. Is that the time when you are actually planning to deliver a cross-cultural training, or is it post-arrival or after the person arrives into the new country, then it has to be given. Then last phase is the evaluation of the effectiveness of cross-cultural training. It is said to be effective when an expatriate has acquired the necessary capabilities to live comfortably in the new environment. So effectiveness is generally judged by taking a feedback from the trainees, and also while they are working on the overseas assignment, that time it can be assessed. So these are the various phases of cross-cultural training. Now this is basically focused on an expatriate who leaves his parent country and goes to a home country, host country, and work there. The second type of training is HCN training, post-country national training, that is wherein the subsidiary is being getting set up, there we are planning to train the host nationals, that is people belonging to that specific country. So how to train them? So grooming an HCN to take up the responsibilities of heading the host unit is equally important from the training perspective. So you would find actually the same phases as what is given in the cross-cultural training. First, starting up with the setting up of objectives, then types of assignments which are to be decided here, whether it has to be a structured reproducer or operational requirements, then need analysis, what is the requirements out of the job, goals and measures, develop and deliver the HCN training, various methods have to be adopted, and finally the assessment of the effectiveness of the training has to be taken up. We can also cover one framework which is developed by Tung, and he has given this framework in 1981, which actually describes the rigor level of a training, what should be the content part, whether it should be focused on cultural issues or it should be more focused on operational issues. So you can see here at the x-axis we have one dimension, degree of interaction, which means what is the level of interaction between the host country and the parent country, whether it is close, whether it is, there is no interaction at all, or there is some form of control. Another dimension is cultural novelty on the y-axis you can see, and here you see that cultural novelty means how far these two countries are unique in their cultures, and there is nothing which corresponds or relates to each other. So that is cultural novelty here. Now here you can see When we talk about the degree of interaction is low and the cultural novelty is also low. So here, you know, having low cultural novelty is somewhat there are similar cultures and the degree of interaction is also low here. So the training would be more focused on job related issues, right? Because the culture is quite similar, so it would not be focused on more of cultural issues. While on the other hand, if you look into the higher perspective of it, where the rigor level is, where the degree of interaction is high and the cultural novelty is also high, that means the cultures are very unique. Both the cultures are very different from each other and it would require a high rigor level. And at the same time, the training is going to be focused on more of cultural related issues. So it helps, this framework actually helps in designing a cross-cultural training program. What should be the content part and what should be the rigor level of a training. Lastly, what are the trends in training for competitive advantage? Now these are certain trends like what is going on around in the world, which is recent. So first thing is computer-based training, wherein you know people actually go to specific centers and they have all those videos played by and people learn through computers. So that is computer-based training, which is a very happening thing. Second is video books. Video books are actually the recorded videos and they are being downloaded by the trainee. And then that trainee goes through the various books which are being provided, various recorded lectures which you know which he wants to listen and which he wants to learn. So those are video books. Then corporate sponsorship of skills certification programs. Now this is also a recent trend, that is the companies actually sponsor some amount every year on their employees so that they can go through certain certification programs and learn the required skill. That is the requirement you know which is which a form of training which fulfills the skill gap and it helps the employee also in growing in the organization and it also works as one of the very important retention tool or techniques. So this is what we wanted to cover today, all the staffing issues and the training issues pertaining to the international or overseas assignment. Thank you.